Okay, first we open Firefox, go to our course companion website. We need two seeds, so I will run my second seed as well. This is my seed 2. Okay, switch back to seed 1. That is my seed 1. Go to lab 05. Here we open this description. Shock attack lab from seed security labs. The task file 6 server or 4 file 6. What? It's a 4 file 6, not 6 file 7. So in task file, task 4 first, launch the Shock attack. After the above CGI program is set up, we can now launch the Shell Shock attack. The attack does not depend on what's in the CGI program. It does not matter because it only targets the batch program, which is invoked first before the CGI script is executed. So our goal is to launch the attack through this URL, such that we can achieve something that we cannot do as a remote user. In this task, you should demonstrate these achievements using the Shell Shock attack to steal the content of a secret file from the server. Second one, answer the following questions. Will you be able to steal the content of the shadow file? Why and why not? Actually, we demonstrated during the lecture. Now let's do it again. In seed 2, I have those two CGI programs. So I switched to seed 2 to make a verification. If you didn't have those programs, you can copy those CGI programs from our course companion website to its corresponding folder. Its folder is called user and lab. CGI lab. You can see I have two CGI programs there and one PHP file there. And that's a CGI program. You can see its content. User lab CGI. Actually, those programs are in our course companion website. You can see it there. You need to remember change them to a executable file. You see they show green, the executable. Here you see the contents of this CGI 3. CGI 3 shows the environment variable. Oh, it's a running process. If you use that alias dash L, you will see its access rights. Here you see the XX, which means executable by anyone. That's last X, my proc 2 and my proc 3. So if you didn't copy them to this folder, please copy them to this folder in your seed 2. Now you switch back to seed 1, we should be able to access these two CGI program. Here, open a new tab. I know my seed 2 IP address, right? It's 10.20.30.22. Followed by that CGI bin forward slash. You see access during the lectures, so they are still here. For CGI 2, it just shows hello world. 然后 CGI3 it show that batch program execute this in my proc3.cgi. It's an environment white box. Here you see all the environment white box. And we are interested in those environment white box can be set or modified by the client side. Actually, these can all be set in a client side. A convenient one is this user agent. Here you see currently I use Firefox to access this web page. So the user agent is this Mozilla Firefox. If I use command line, it will show the name of the command line. So I would like to create a folder to hold anything generated today. Go to ITS 450, create a folder called lab05. Inside lab05, then I open terminal. Actually, I open terminal first, then copy its address, go to this folder. So I'm inside this folder right now. We can use a curl, this command, right? This curl command dash V means to show verbose contents dash A, which means to set up the agent as we have just demonstrated last week. We say test data. Right, test data. Then this test data will be passed to the server side environment. So we can see it HTTP. Actually, we can copy it from this one. Copy. Come here. Paste here. Right, this is how do we access from command line. And you can see the output. Here, these are the content requests sent to the server. You can see this user agent test data. And the response from the server side, it shows all the environment variables. The interesting variable is this one, HTTP user agent test data, just passed from our client side. Because it's passed into the environment variable. And we also know it on the server side, it has that bash share shock vulnerability, which can be exploited. Here, I switch to CD2. You see this is my proc 3.cgi. It calls this vulnerable version bash share shock. So which means that we can exploit this one. How do we exploit that one? By defining a function contains attack code through environment variables, right? Switch back to C1. Now how do we construct that one? We just change this environment variable, HTTP user agent. We want to construct the environment variable definition or function like this, echo normal. Right, this is normal, just a normal code for our function. Now, the interesting part is this extra part. The extra part, how do we set up this extra part? In this extra part, we want to set up a reverse shell. Right? We want to set up a reverse shell in that extra part here in order to steal the content of secret files from the server or try to steal this etc shadow. Actually, we have two ways. The ultimate way we can set up a reverse shell, then we can do lots of things. This is done in task file. In task 4, we can just run some extra command, for example, ls and cat, right? Cat is used to show the file contents. But we need to know the on the server side where is that cat command. As we learned in last class, since we all use seed, we know what it is. We can use a verification here. We open a new terminal to type which cat, so you can find the complete address of that cat command. Without this complete address, it will be ignored on the server side, as we demonstrated during the class. Or we can find that ls that were under this bin folder. So in our attack code, we construct like this, the extra command. We use bin ls to list out all those files and that triple W folder, right? And that triple W folder, we can just write it's an absolute path. It's called where www. Usually, this is not given to us because we just have two seeds that we know where it is. But in the real world, you need to do some investigation first to find where they are. We want to supply a big R parameter or switch, which means we want to show its contents recursively. So now we can run this one to see what we can get. But we still need to add some contents. Otherwise, this output, the output on the server side, we are not able to see them, right? How do we do that? We need to set up the header port before we output the listed files. How do we set up that HTTP header? As we have done that part in our CGI program, we need to show echo. So what's that part? We go to our seed tool to check that part. Here, echo content type is this text plain echo. Then we actually that's good enough. We only need to set up this one and add a new line. Content dash type text plain. We only need this one. Go back to our seed one. So echo, because we use a double quote outside, so we can use single quote here. Content type is a text plain. And we want to do an echo again. Then we use this bin ls to list out all those files on the server under this folder. And we know if that server hosts some websites, we may be able to access the secret files from those websites as we steal the password during the lecture. So now I press enter. After I press enter, I didn't find that stuff show up. So, which means there are some mistakes I made here. I have all this stuff, but this echo is not triggered. So we can verify our definition why it's not triggered. Here is the normal. This the normal function definition, right? There's normal function definition. And we have extra code. The problem is I missed a single code after this text print. Here, a single code. Monitor again. Actually, we steal all the information from the server. Here are all the files. Now we need to identify which file is a secret, which file is not secret. As we learned in the lecture, we know there is a settings file for that ELGG website is a secret file. So you can go up to find that settings. It's better save or output in a file as we demonstrated in the lecture. Otherwise, some information are scrolled away. So we can try this again. We want to save it. Save it, and let's just call it server.information.txt. Okay, now it's saved. We use a Pluma, we use a sub-L to open this server.info-info.txt. Now we have all this stuff, we can just find them. For example, under this folder, we know there are some subfolders, CSRF, SS, actual injection, and so on. There are file websites. These are default websites. Here are another two web applications. So for that CSRF, here CSRF, we can find to see that is a settings.php under this folder. So we can.
Can I see the command again for the.
The command of yours?
Yeah, the curl, whatever.
The curl command. So please take notes right now because I will post this video later. Try to understand the step first. And now go to here, we see this one, we know CSRF, we copy this one. And also we know the password in this file, settings.php. So we can go back to our terminal window. This time we want to change this one. We just want to list out a single file. We want to cat the its content, right? We use a cat. Oops, I didn't copy that folder. Here, go back to copy this folder first. Oops. Paste over there. You'll see that I've written myself dash info.txt because there is a new line at the end accidentally. So I need to add settings.php. So this time I just save it as settings.php. Just save it like this. This is our curl command used to steal the secret information. Press enter. You can use ls on our local machine. I have two files, steal the two files. The second one is the settings.php. Again, I want to use sub-L to open this settings.php to find the secret information. You can see here the username and password for the database. So this is the secret information we steal from the server. We complete one task here. Complete this one. We steal the content of a secret file from the server. Now the second one, will you be able to steal the contents of this one? Why and why not? So we can try it, right? As we demonstrated in the lecture, we can check our user ID or effective user ID we have when we hacked into this server. We use that bin ID, right? Bin ID to show what kind of ID we have. Here, that bin ID, let's see its output. I got bin ID. So that bin ID, this is the response. That's the one we submit to the server side. Now, for this bin ID, we didn't see an output. So why is that? Because we just guess that ID is over there. We need to confirm where is that ID. Actually, that ID is on the user bin ID. So on the server side, it may not like our client side. It's because just we use a seed, all these seeds are the same or identical. On real world, you need to do some investigation. So it's on the user bin ID. Now this time you see this, the content that we get. The user ID is www-data. And this is a very limited user ID. You cannot do lots of things on the server. Now let's try to steal that shadow file. So what's the location of that shadow file? Here, you can see it says that shadow file is under this etc shadow. Again, I suggest you to confirm it on our local computer. Here is etc shadow. You see it's there, the shadow. Even on our local computer, when we try to access this shadow user cat, you see permission denied. So on the server side, it's very likely we were not able to access it just like this one because of our www-data. This is even more limited than normal users. So how could we do that? We would like to use that cat command again. So that cat command is under this bin folder, right? Bin cat followed by that shadow file. Shadow, right? But now if there are any error, we will not be able to see those errors. So we want to redirect the error to our client side. Here, if I just run it, you will see no output. Why is that? Because on my local computer here, these are actually their output to those standard error. Not standard output, that's why we cannot see it. We can use a redirection, right? Redirect that standard error. We know standard error is device number is a file descriptor is 2. Standard input is 0. Standard output is 1. Standard error is 2. 2 to output to the standard input. We need this syntax. You will learn more in IDS 372. So now on this time where we are sure I will be able to see an error message. Here you see this error message. Permission denied. So we cannot access, we cannot steal the contents of that shadow file because the www-data that user ID has no privilege to see the contents of this shadow file. So we completed a task 4. Now let's go to task 5, getting a reverse shell via shell shock attack. During the lecture, I demonstrated how to create a reverse shell. Reverse shell is the ultimate goal for a hacker to achieve. Once you get a reverse shell, you can execute all those alarm commands with the user ID you get, with the user access rights or privilege you have. Here it says the shell shock vulnerability allows attacks to run arbitrary commands on the target machine in real attacks instead of hard coding, just as we did in task 4. Hard coding the command in their attacks. Attacks often choose to run a shell command so they can use the shell to run other commands. So you can read this stuff by yourself as we demonstrated during the lecture. How do we launch a, we wanted to know how to launch a shell shock attack. We only need to know how to set up a reverse shell. Right? To simplify your lab, I put those commands in our lecture. Here, go to our lectures. In module 01, shell shock attack. In the code part, shell shock. I put a reverse shell, how to set up it. We need this netcat to set up a listening server on our local machine. Then construct this exploitation. The key part is here. This command. We run bash interactively. Redirect is output to the standard or to this network connection, and also redirect the standard input to that network connection. The standard error redirect to that network connection, because this one standard output is already redirected to this network connection first. So now we can use this technique. It's a bin batch dash I redirect to DV TCP attacker IP and the NC netcat port number. So that's it. We need to run netcat on our local machine first. So go to our terminal window. I would like to split this terminal window into two parts. The top part, I run that netcat NC listen verbose output port number. You can choose any number you want, but better use some user port number, and you learn the port number allocation. In ITS, I think it's ITS 135. So here we can choose, for example, 6666. Okay, I run this one on my local machine. Now it's listening on that port number. And I know my seed one is IP is 10.20.30.11. So now I can construct that attack, right? We can copy this one. Paste here. Why I left one character? Because I don't want that it be executed right away if we copy that new line. So I type here, then it will not execute automatically. So in this part, this key part, the extra command or the attack command We only change this part. We already know that bash is on the bin bash. We can confirm it again with a reach command bash, bin bash, right? It's on here, or you can use Z shell or other shell you want. Here we just use this bin bash. So we need to type the full path bin bash dash I. You can find how to use this bash. I type man bash. Here you can see this bash, how to use it. Option, command string, files, and so on. You can find that dash I, what does it mean? Interactive, and so on. You can find other options to try other options you want to practice more. Now, for that one, dash I, then we want to redirect, right? So redirect to DEV, TCP, then followed by the IP address. The IP address is the local machine, the attack machine, 10.20.30.11, then followed by that port number. How do we specify that port number? We can check this link again. We use a forward slash. Usually we use a colon, but here we use a forward slash to separate this stuff. DEV, TCP, attack IP, NC port. Redirect the input, redirect the arrow. So here, I only need to specify my port number specified here. My port number specified here is 66666. So it's 4 sixes. Then I need to redirect that input, standard input. Also redirect that standard output. Pay attention to this direction of these symbols. This is to the right side, this is to the left side. Why we use to the left side? For standard input, which means the input for this standard input is from this standard output. Okay, we specify it like this, right? So that's it. Now we can press enter to see on the client side, could we get a connection from the server and give us an interactive bash? Press enter on the client side. You see something, error happened, cannot set terminal process. This is okay, right? As we demonstrate here, you see this part. The user is a www-data at the server machine is still called VM. And the working present folder is that user libc that dash bin. We know that folder contains our CGI program. Now you can type any commands you want, right? Type ls, you see this stuff. Type ls, etc, shadow. You see that shadow is there. If you want to see the contents, shadow, you see permission denied. If you want to steal that secret PHP file, you can also use a cat command here, followed by that folder. Right? What that folder? We can scroll back to find that folder. So that folder is here. You can copy this part. Paste here. Now you see we work interactively to the server. This bash is provided by the server. So you see all the contents of that secret file. You see that password. As well as length settings, the database is on the top. The database password. So you see, it's better cell in the file. Here you see all this stuff. But as we work indirectly to the server, if you sell to a file, actually it's saved on the server. User in the cat can download files from the server. If you are interested, you can check the help menu. Go in the cat by yourself. Currently, we just demonstrate how to set up a reverse share and use this reverse share to complete the achievements we did in task 4. Right? So this is a task file. We completed a task file. Now we left only one task, that task 6, using the patched bash. Go to the description. Task 6, now let's use a bash program that has already been patched. The program bash is a patched version. Replace the first line of your C# program with this program. Redo task 3 and 5 and describe your observations to see what you we can get. So we need to switch to seed 2. So go to switch 2. We cd to that folder contains the CGI programs. User lib, CGI, burn. Here, we are here. The best way, we just make a copy. Always make a backup. My probe2.cgi, I call it good2. Good2.cgi. Actually, as it said, the CGI program does not matter. We need only one, it's good enough. So it's not necessary to make two. And it also does not matter if you use which one. Right? This time we use the second one. The second one just give us a hello world. Permission denied, we need a sudo. Okay, now we have a good tool, sudo subl to change the good tool.cgi. We only need to modify the first line, which means which batch we want to use. We don't want to use this one or one, so delete the underscore share shock. Just leave this bin batch. So this is the good one. Ctrl S, save it. And close it. The name is good2.cgi. So on the client side, you need to supply the file name, the CGI file name. So I can try it here. On the Firefox first, we create a good tool, right? good2.cgi. Now you see hello world again. But this hello world is generated by that bash program, which is patched. The share shock vulnerability is removed. So we can practice those attack again. How do we do that? We need to exit this task file. Exit this in interactive share first. Actually, it's okay, you leave it there. You can do it in this second part. You just copy those commands and paste here. We need to do two of them, right? First one, that tool is good enough to demonstrate, but it's better you just repeat all the commands you have done in task file. In task file, we did several commands, but at least you need to demonstrate set up the share shock or set up the reverse share and steal that secret information. So you may try this first. Try to set up interactive bash first, but it looks like it's still better to exit this share, interactive share. Why? Because we need to run the nc-cat again. Otherwise, you need to run another nc-netcat and change the port number. So we exit. Now we need to run that nc cal command again. So we can change this port number. Is it okay? You use the old port number. I would like to change 555. Now here we need to change that port number to 5555. I want to set up the interactive shell first, right? Here we need to run this nc-cat first. It's listening. Now on the bottom window, I press enter. I only changed that 555. I didn't modify anything else, right? In one version, we will get a connection from the server to our netcat. Now, our that batch is fixed. Press enter. Oops, you still see this stuff. The reason is, so what the reason? The reason because my proc 3, I use my proc 3. Proc 3 is still use that bad batch. So let's exit. We didn't use that good batch. So run this nc-cat again. Here we need to use that good batch. So it's a good tool. Good tool. Press enter. To see, you need to pay attention to see whether you can get the interactive shell. Here you just see a hello world. The output of that hello world. You don't see anything connect to our nc-cat. So which means the reverse shell failed. The only reason is this extra command is not executed in that hashed version of batch. So we failed the second one. Now we also need to demonstrate if we fail steal that secret PHP file. So I would like to control C stop this one. Just bring back my command how to steal that PHP file. I don't want to type it again, right? Here is how do we steal that settings. The only thing I need to modify is the good bash, good tool, good tool.cji. We press under. But it's better removed because we want to see in the terminal window first. In the terminal window, again, we only see the hello world. We didn't see anything further. So which means it's just because this extra command is not executed in the hashed version.